Who the hell is that guy? I'm just kidding. What's up? Episode 25 of 84 Feet with Cady and Cap. I'm Brian Cady. That's Brian Capitula, head coach of Albany Academy, defending two-time Section 2 Class B champions, two-time New York State Final Four appearances, and a proud father of one. Mr. Capitula, how are you, sir?
I'm good. How are you?
I'm doing well. Glad to see you nice and refreshed from your little vacay that you took. A lot of stuff happening around Section 2 in the last few weeks. It's a little wild, hasn't it?
Yeah, a lot of teams have changed. Players have left some teams, and landscapes have changed. Coaches are getting hired left and right, so it's good. Scotia, they don't know who their coach is yet, I don't think, still. And then the football thing popped up too, if you saw that.
I was going to say, you know, it's bad. Forget the girls' basketball coach. They don't even know if they have the proper accreditations, I guess,
right,
for their current football staff. So that's
wild.
That's just wild. I think this is the most chaotic start to a high school academic year athletics-wise that I've seen in a while, just between the weird stories and obviously the whole Bethlehem situation, which
right.
That's a whole nother topic for a whole nother kind of show that isn't here. But obviously we put our thoughts out there to everyone in Bethlehem that went through that craziness since we're recording this on September 17th. So this is last week when it happened. Steve Giglio, the Hilly Names basketball head coach, he also coaches, I believe it's field hockey, over at Bethlehem. And he was actually on site for a practice for his team when all that was going down with the emergency lockdown and that stuff. Just glad everyone's safe. Nothing happened. And now it sounds like they're investigating that it was somebody outside the immediate area that did it, that made the threats.
Oh, geez. So,
at least that's the latest as of this morning from what I've been reading.
Sure.
They're saying it was somebody outside of the capital region that made the threatening calls. And
it's nuts.
It's wild and crazy world we live in, but just thankful, obviously, that nothing actually happened and everybody's safe, and hopefully we can return some kind of state of normalcy pretty soon.
Right.
That all being said, let's get a little happy now. Enough of the sad and depressing
dreary
stuff. Let's stop talking about potential school violence and all that jazz. We don't need to talk about that. We don't need to talk about people that aren't accredited to be coaches in Section 2. We need to talk about those that are accredited. We need to talk about programs that have figured things out and are on the way up. And that brings us to Greenville. Yes, the Spartans from the Patroon Conference in Section 2. They just brought in a new head coach. I don't know if it was actually when he was hired, but the announcement came out about a month ago. He is also the main man behind Cap City Scrappers and a special showcase event that's coming up. Since we're recording this on the 17th, that's going to be in 11 days, if I know how to count right. The man, the myth, the legend, Bobby Shields. What's going on, man?
How you doing, guys? Thanks for having me.
Thanks, Bobby.
Absolutely. Not a problem, man. Glad to have you on. First things first. Let's dive into the history, the biopic of Bobby Shields for a hot second. Just a little bit of your background, being around the area now, where you come from, where'd you go to school, and what led you into want to be around the sport of basketball?
Yeah, so, I probably started playing since I was like 9 years old. Went to Bethlehem High School. Played a couple of years there, varsity, finished up, and I just decided to take that path and start coaching. Started playing a bunch at the park, and eventually just started getting kids in the gym, and you know, that's when we launched the program. And we literally started with like 7 kids in the back of my, you know, truck. So we started in 2015, and you know, we're going on year 10. So you know, been coaching for about 10 years now, and you know, truly passionate about it, and just try to keep growing every year.
So staying on the club side and stuff, things, and thanks for coming on, Bob. Obviously, we'll touch on both, like, club side stuff and high school stuff, but just sticking on the club side. So, like, you've been 10 years in now. What has changed, like, in terms of players in the last 10 years? Like, what would you say is the biggest difference between players now to when you first started everything?
I feel like nowadays the players are more serious about school and, you know, grades and everything. Obviously, talent is up and down. You know, there's off years with that. But it seems like, you know, the individual players are getting better in the classroom, which is good.
I just want to put a certain focus, because you mentioned the talent. You know, it peaks and valleys. You know, there's going to be hot durations. There's going to be hot classes, and you know, a few years in a row, and then might be, not to say that they're bad players, but you know, just like the ceilings become a little different from class to class. But it feels like right now, focusing specifically on the girls' side, I mean, these classes of 25, 26, 27, 28, I mean, they're about as red hot, and you can obviously add in the last couple years as well. I mean, they're about as red hot and ripe with legitimate next-level talent across the board. And what have you been seeing just through the developments over the last couple of years on the girls' side, how you feel about what's been going on there?
I think there's definitely a lot of undiscovered talent in our area. And, you know, we have a lot of talent that, you know, is definitely under-recruited, in my opinion. You know, and obviously on the AAU side, you know, it's our job to kind of get it out there. And it's tough in the school season, you know, not all coaches get out to games. It's tough for them. So, you know, just trying to do the best, you know, on our end to get it out there. And, you know, I know Cap knows. You know, I'm sure he's in touch with a bunch of coaches. He's helping getting girls to the next level, and that's very important.
And for some reason, just it's very strange, this area. Like, there, for whatever reason, there's kind of like a disconnect a little bit. Like, we get a ton of Division III coaches that'll come. It seems like that's always like our first thing. But then all of a sudden, there's Division II coaches like, oh, this kid's here. And I don't know what that is. Like, I don't know how to change that. It's a big upstate thing, though, I think. Like, they think, like, below Syracuse, there's not much basketball. And then there's kind of like a lap. So it's a weird thing. I think us having really not a Division II program in our area anymore isn't helping either. Like, having St. Rose here before, I think that helped a little bit, because at least the kids might get some interest from St. Rose, which then jumps other NE10 schools on. But
right.
It's a weird thing that's happened for sure. But
and I think we're just as talented as Syracuse area, to be honest.
Right. And if you look at like the success of the teams, me and Brian always talk about, like, 4 out of the 6 teams obviously were Section 2 teams in the state finals this year. So
right.
That says something right there. So now on terms of the coaching side of things, obviously you got involved, and I know you a little bit from Mohannesson, and we were coaching together a little bit there. What made you want to coach, like, at the high school level? Obviously, you have your club thing that goes on. You've built a really successful program on that side. But what kind of motivated you to kind of jump into the high school side of things?
Pretty much just because I'm passionate about it. I want to be coaching pretty much every month of the year. So, you know, that's part of the reason I'm like, you know, 100% on board with coaching. And, you know, I wanted to coach school and AAU. So
now, obviously, it's been mentioned earlier how You know, Cap City, it's been 10 years getting celebrated right now at the program. Who would you say are a couple of the key spokes in the wheel of success that's made, that's allowed the program to grow with you and all the players that have been involved? Who are like a couple of the key players, and not even necessarily coaches, could be people just behind the scenes doing like administrative stuff or fundraising or whatever it may be. Who have been the key MVPs behind the scenes?
There's definitely been a lot, just to mention a few. Vance Perella, Charlie Bianchino, Deshaun Wall, and Levon Hernandez, a couple past players and coaches. You know, it's really been a team effort, obviously. No one can do it themselves, and you know, you have to have open arms and be able to have people come in and help. So, you know, it's a lot of help behind the scenes that, you know, helped us get to this point. And I'm just grateful to have great people around me. So
now with the Greenville job, obviously coach steps down. His daughter played, right? Like, I think the head coach's daughter, that was his last year. Her last year was last year. What interests you about like being a coach at a school that they've had a really good successful 2 years in a row, back to back in the B's? At first, how did you find out about the position? And then what interested you about that job?
So a couple of our players' mothers actually reached out and said I should apply and think I would be a great fit. And obviously I knew Kevin and Gip already, so I've had a lot of contact with them. I went to games the last couple of years. So, you know, it just felt like the right move. And I think, you know, I was ready to run a high school program. I had a great experience the last 4 years at Academy being an assistant, but it was just time to be a head coach and run a program myself.
How long, roughly, did the whole process take? Because, you know, Cap had mentioned how the head coach Smith, his daughter Emily, she was a senior last year. So I'm assuming it was kind of a predisposed, you know, foregone conclusion that this was going to happen. So how long did this all take as far as, you know, getting the interview and going through the whole process before you actually were able to get the gig?
Probably 2 months. So I was in talks with the AD. We eventually set up an interview. And then, you know, a couple weeks after the interview, she ended up calling and offering me the job. And, you know, now we're at the step where we're going to open the gym up for some open gyms and stuff and get started soon.
Now you're taking, like, obviously you're at Academy and had a really dynamic group of boys coming from the boys' side. You've done the girls' side in the past as well, and you did the girls' side this summer. But coming from like the boys' side to the girls' side, what do you bring in terms of like from coaching boys and at a really high level of the boys' side? What do you look to translate over to the girls' side, like at Greenville? Like, what will you take? Are you going to be an up-tempo, fast team? Are you going to – obviously, you have to play to what you have personnel-wise, but – in a perfect world, like how do you see your team playing?
I'm not going to give anything away yet, but you know, obviously I got to see what we're working with. A couple of the girls I already know, but you know, I always like to play fast and up tempo, push the ball, and it's just like I just want to make sure we're consistent and we're getting better every week. You know, Greenville is not a huge basketball school, but they do have, you know, athleticism, and you know, it's my job to work on that and develop those girls, and you know, so hopefully we can take advantage and do the best we can with them.
Yeah, and get a look at that squad you're going to be taking over. Just lost four of the girls from last year's squad at graduation, but still have a pretty young core with three freshmen and four sophomores from last year. Obviously, now they're going to be sophomores and juniors, including Charlotte Dawson, the 5'8 5'8 guard, going to be returning for the Spartans. All in all, obviously Charlotte's a big part of everything moving forward. But aside from Charlotte, who are some of the other girls that are returning that you think should be slept on and deserve a bit of a light being shown on them going into the season?
Definitely Bryn Fitzmorris. She's a 1,000-point scorer, shooter. She's a senior this year. She'll be a big piece of our offense, and Charlotte's a rising sophomore. To be honest, those are the only two I really know right now. So, definitely those are going to be key pieces. And then, hopefully we get some girls at tryouts that can help us in certain areas.
This isn't a question we've asked too many of the coaches before, which I don't know why we haven't, but how do you, like, obviously basketball – and I know what it is just because, and Brian knows what it is because he hears me complain all the time, but how do you maintain like your own mental health? Like with this being like a 10, 11 month season for you, like managing the pressures of coaching, the home stuff, things like that, like any one thing, like where you go to decompress, or any one person that you can go to kind of, like, I need to relax. Like this needs to slow down.
It's definitely tough. Thank God for my wife. She helps me decompress and, let's go on a little getaway this weekend, or, let's take a break from basketball. But it's something I love to do. So, I'm blessed to be able to do something I love. And, to me, it's not too much stress anymore because, obviously, that's what I want to be around and that's what I want to do. So
now taking a look around Class B, obviously Greenville was very successful before falling to Fonda Fultonville in the Section 2 quarters last year. Obviously coming in, there's programs on the rise or programs looking to maintain their status within Section 2 coming into this year with Maple Hill, Mechanicville, Stillwater, Coxsackie, Athens. Who are those pretty much the main squads you're looking at as like the main competition in Class B? And how do you feel about that competition from the looks of things?
It'll probably be Maple Hill, Catskill. I heard that Chatham's going to be a little bit better this year. I'm not sure. I heard this year is pretty much a mix-up, but Maple Hill is always solid, so I think that's going to be one of our tougher matchups in conference.
I texted you a few times, but anything non-conference that you have planned, whether the girls are playing a little bit better team or they're playing up in A level, double A level, anything like that, you have set yet?
So I got the job a little late, so I was kind of behind the gun. A lot of coaches I reached out to, their schedules were already full.
Yep.
We recently just got Whitesboro, which I think will be a good matchup for us, Saugerties, and Mechanicville. So we're still looking for one more game as of now, but, hopefully those will be pretty good matchups for us.
Great.
Yeah.
For sure.
When you look at the way the game in general has evolved recently on the girls' level, obviously there's a lot of attention on, the big class that just came into the WNBA this summer with Caitlin Clark and Angel Reese and Cardozo and that whole crew, Cameron Brink. But just overall, the girls' game, how do you feel about the way it's been evolving at the higher levels, both the college and now obviously the WNBA level, and what that does for trying to get girls to commit into being, part of the sport, maybe not just looking at it as so much of a hobby anymore, but maybe making that the main thing they focus on and the kind of work that they're putting into it?
I think it's great for the sport because obviously it's going to open it up to more people. And I think there's a lot of girls who can play and have, you know, athleticism and skill that don't play. So I think it's opening it up to more, like, you know, for girls to try it out, and hopefully they like it and they can take it somewhere.
Now, Greenville, just going through records and stuff, just from what you're inheriting, you're not inheriting a program that didn't win, right? So 14-6 in 2022, 2023. Last year, I think they're, 19-2 last year? First in the league. So they win the league. They win the Patroon, which is just a kind of a gritty, tough league. You know, like you said, you have Catskill, Taconic Hills, Chatham, Waterville, Kentucky, Athens. Have you started anything in terms of, obviously, you just getting the job and stuff, but and you may know just from like the AAU circuit and things, but any players in the league that you're looking forward to either playing or not playing because of you have some really good quality players in that league?
To be honest, I think the only girl I really know is the Brisky girl, I think. Is that Kutsaki?
Yep.
That's the only one I've really been familiar with. Besides that, I honestly don't know as many other players. So,
sure.
You know, I don't know what I'm walking into, and I like that. So,
yeah. And a lot of the stuff too, which is good. What COVID created, it created a lot of video that you're able to obtain, like whether it be huddle online and stuff. So there's a lot of video that we never had playing. You never really knew what the team you were going to play. Like there's a lot of stuff you can go and resources and things. So, but yeah, Kentucky Athens, watching them in person last year in our gym play Stillwater before we played. Bailey's got great size. I really like how she plays. And I think they would be the one team probably in the league that may be challenging a little bit, like in terms of overall, depending on what you guys have. But I think that you guys should be able to compete. Like, I guess it's a league 19-2. That doesn't happen by accident, no matter who's on the roster. So,
right. Yeah, no, I'm excited for it. I remember actually watching that game. I was at that game before you guys played. So, I'm looking forward to the challenge.
So, getting a look now, because another reason why we brought you on this the program is you're running a showcase coming up, which we will be on location at in the Albany Colony kind of town line area, that little weird gray area where, you know, you're not sure if you're writing stuff to go to Albany or writing stuff to go to Colony kind of area. Our Savior's Christian School, which is right near Colony South, Colony Central is what I mean to say. Colony Central High School. It's called the 518 Superior Showcase. It's going to be the girls' side running from 11 a.m. to 1 p.m., followed by the boys, 1 to 3. First off, just talk about how long you've been running this showcase and what made you want to put this together and how it's been going so far with, you know, it's coming up as of recording time, you know, in 11 days. So clock's certainly ticking about it getting here.
Yeah, so started about 3 years ago. This is the first year on the girls' side, so just wanted to bring them in as part of it and, you know, just give the kids opportunity to get seen in a smaller setting. You know, it's crazy in AAU. Obviously, there's games everywhere. There's multiple courts. We just wanted to make a center stage so, you know, all the athletes can get seen in one spot. So, you know, we do a couple drills here and there just to get them warmed up first 20 minutes, and then we pretty much let them run. And, you know, we'll usually match up the better players at the end so everybody can see them play against the best competition. So it's been really good the last couple of years.
Now, do you have any in terms of players that are coming in 11 days, and this will obviously be on before that, but any players that you have signed up now that you're looking forward to watching?
On the girls' side?
On the girls' side, yeah.
So the girls' side is I can bring up the list on the real quick. So we made like some committed posts on Instagram just to get the word out so coaches can see them in advance and obviously, you know, see who's coming. So we have Maggie Vollmer from Holy Names, Charlotte Dawson from Greenville. We got the Wolf Twins from Greenwich. We got Summer Perry from Broad Auburn. Boston Spa, Kaylee Richards and Jessica Bowens, Sydney Pleat from Colony. So those are some of the names that, you know, that are on there. Gianna Winter is one of your girls, right, Kat?
Yep.
From Shen. So there's some good talent, you know, and hoping a few more sign up, you know, to fill the gym. You know, there's a good amount of coaches coming. I think we're around 18 right now on the girls' side. So prep schools and colleges. So it'll be a little mix.
That's great.
As somebody who has the unique perspective of being both an AAU coach as well as a school ball coach, how important do you feel events like this are for the athletes that are, you know, really considering playing at the next level?
I think it's really important, especially if they didn't get recruited much over the summer. So especially if you're at 25 or 26, if you're not talking to no coaches right now, you have to be at this event or other events. You know, get at the showcases or prospect camps, whatever you can. But it totally depends on, you know, who the player is talking to at this moment. So I guess it's different for everyone, but it's not only just to get recruited. Some players should just come and compete, you know, get their name out there even more. You never know who's watching. We're going to try to have a stream on YouTube as well this time, so outside coaches can watch as well.
Now, this is obviously this next question is kind of a hot debate, and you're both and I'm both. So, and at some point, high school basketball just lost its luster, even on the boys, like I would say the boys side and the girls side, like where high school basketball was kind of like, I don't know if it was school pride that kind of went away a little bit or whatever it may have been. But in your mind, like AAU basketball, high school basketball, like, at this point, like, which one would you say holds the most significance overall? Like, reflecting on who you're going to be as a person, like, down the line. Like, obviously, I feel like AAU is great for putting you out there. But my own opinion is, like, the character and the team building and things like that that you get from high school is just unmatched.
I agree. Because, obviously, you got to be with them 6 days a week. The more unity is with school ball, especially if you have, you know, AAU teams, you got kids from all over the place. You probably only practice two or three times a week, if that. So I agree. The unity is definitely school ball. I think the AAU aspect is very important for, you know, recruitment being challenged. For certain players, because you don't always see the same competition in school ball, so it's a little different there. So you know, either it's school ball or AAU, it's still all good basketball. And you know, as long as you have a good surrounding around you and good coaches and players.
All right, man. Well, what we do is to wrap up every show, we have all of our guests do some lighthearted rapid fire questions. Trust me, there is nothing serious about this. Just, you know, some challenging opinions we're looking for. Just rapid fire, whatever first answer comes to your head. It's called Life's Most Important Questions. Are you ready, Bobby?
Yes, sir.
All right. Number one, Gatorade, Powerade, or other when it comes to energy drinks?
Gatorade.
Okay. Certain color?
Blue. Light blue.
Okay. All right. Okay. Speaking of flavors, favorite Starburst?
Yellow.
Oh, man.
Is that our first yellow cap?
That might be the first yellow ever.
All right. Okay. What goes in the bowl first, the cereal or the milk?
Cereal.
Okay. Is a hot dog a sandwich?
No.
When it comes to sweets, are you a chocolate guy or a vanilla guy?
That's a tough one. Probably vanilla.
Okay. Last one. If you were on a deserted island and you had your pick of two people to help you get off the island and back into civilization, who are the two people you're picking and why?
Sorry, say that again.
You're on a deserted island and you're trying to get off the island. Who are the two people you trust the most to help you get off the island?
Any two people.
I would have to say my friend Jake and Todd, just because they're outdoormen. And they could probably help me.
All right. It's a fair. There's no wrong answer. It's fair. That's fair. Bobby Shields, new head coach of the Greenville Spartans of the Patroon Conference, the main man behind the Cap City Scrappers, and the brains behind the 518 Superior Showcase coming up on September the 28th in Albany. Bobby, we appreciate the time. Thanks for stopping by and jumping on with us, and best of luck with everything going forward. And we'll probably catch up down the road. All right, man.
Yes, sir. Thanks for having me. Thanks, Kat.
Thanks, Bobby.
I appreciate you guys, and we'll see you next Saturday.
All right, sounds good, man. Bobby Shields joining the program again. 518 Superior Showcase coming up on the 28th. That is a Saturday. Girls running from 11 to 1, and then the boys from 1 to 3. Lutheran. Well, there's a Lutheran church, and then there's the school. It's at the school, Our Savior's Christian School, 63 Mountain View Ave in Albany, which is literally like a couple blocks away from Colony Central High School. Cap, good stuff. Always good to have the new blood come on and talk us through what went into them getting on board with the school they're at and getting a look at, what's to come.
Yeah, it's funny. So the one thing that, I don't know, you might know, you may not know, the organs are actually from Greenville. So that is like Sean Organ and Colleen Organ. That is their home school. That's where they went to high school.
Hmm. Very interesting. I did not know that.
Yes. So okay. That's a...
Actually, I should remember that because we did have Sean on the show, and I'm pretty sure we mentioned that at one point.
And we at some point we tried to get Green. We did try to get them on our schedule. Fortunately, just didn't work out last year, but we did try to get them on the schedule just to go out, whether we went out there or they came to us, just to play some teams. So, but on schedule wise, like in terms of, I know I had sent you our schedule. Our schedule's done for Academy this year. Thank God. Mm-hmm. Takes forever. So that's like a relief. And now on open gyms, which have just started yesterday. So,
I'm just going to put this out there because I know of, you mentioned how you sent me the schedule. There's a particular game that you have scheduled. Don't have to bring up who it's against. December the 21st, which is a Saturday, if I remember correctly.
22nd. December 22nd.
22nd. Okay. So, question I have. Because you know I'm involved with a Christmas time-ish, two events Christmas time-ish. One before, one after. Has anyone from the event I work with beforehand asked you about moving that game from the current location it's going to be at to somewhere else?
Not yet. But that's one of our seven home games right now. out of our 20 games. So, but not yet.
Might have to do something about that.
I did see, so it's no secret, but it's Columbia on the 22nd. That's supposed to be a home game for us, if that's what you're referring to. I know that they're, yes, they're playing, I think they're playing Red Hook in one of his little tournaments that he's having, that you would be involved in. But yeah, that is one of our seven home games. We don't have many home games this year.
Okay.
But
just throwing it out there. Wasn't sure if he had thought about talking to you, so.
But we might need an announcer for that game. So it's a Sunday. Football's on, but we got streaming. You could go right on your phone, right at the table. Maybe we might need you that day.
I've got NFL Plus on my phone. I can pull up Red Zone. It's not a problem at all. Although, who knows? Maybe by then, well, not maybe, definitely by then, my team's going to be eliminated from playoff contention. So, whatever.
Yeah, the season started. My team was eliminated. So,
who's your squad again?
The Broncos. And they're stuck now because you can't bench the kid once you put him in. Like Bill Belichick said, once you start him, you can't go. So, I mean, our other option is a guy that was drafted by the Jets. So that's, be drafted by the Jets is probably the biggest curse you could ever have. So it's not like.
What do you mean? Look at Sam Darnold right now. Look what he's doing.
It took him like 4 years to shake that. So it took quite a while for him to shake that off and almost hit the restart button. He got redrafted again.
Okay.
And just he needed Kirk Cousins to take that guy. I think if anything shows you just be a nice person and you'll make tons of money and you can be an okay guy at your job and never really excel at it and just keep getting paid, that guy, I don't understand it. But, I mean, obviously he won last night against the Eagles, which everyone I'm sure is exuberant because all the Cowboy fans are now saying the Eagles lost even though their team got killed. So, which is really funny to see. Because the minute their team loses, there's no word. And then as soon as someone else loses, now it's like, oh, my God, the other team lost. So that's just the life of a Cowboys fan, I guess. But that guy just keeps getting paid. Just be a nice person, and you'll get paid at some point, I guess.
Listen. I miss him anyways. I'm always going to miss him. You know how much it did my heart well to see Saquon drop that 3rd-and-3 pass?
Oh, I'm sure. A lot of people, I'm sure that are from. And we've talked about before, our semifinal last year, which you were obviously announcing at. But Nick Sirianni's niece was on Southwestern, and Nick Sirianni's sister-in-law was the head coach, and brother was on the bench. So that trade had happened basically like that morning. It hadn't been really, it had just been announced, and everyone was going up to him and saying, "Don't take him from us." So that was actually pretty funny that he was at that game, and that had just happened at that time. So,
and then you boat raced that team and didn't notice it until 3 minutes left in the game.
No, I mean, he had an underdog hat on too. I did notice that he wore the Philly underdog hat. So, but I apologized after to him.
No apologies. No. You're a Broncos fan. You wouldn't completely understand right now. No.
All gas, no break.
Anyways, enough of the NFL talk. That does it for me. That does it for Cap. That does it for both of us. Thanks again to Bobby Shields from Greenville for joining the program and the Cap City Scrappers again. 518 Superior Showcase. Say that 3 times fast without adding an H to superior. Saturday, the 20th of September. Girls side 11-1, boys side 1-3. Our Savior's Christian School in Albany. We'll be there. That's the part I haven't really been plugging a whole lot. I'll be there with a little table set up in the lobby doing short form interviews with a bunch of the girls that are going to be there. And then releasing them onto our YouTube channel after the fact. So, definitely keep an eye out for that. In fact, I have the list of confirmations right in front of me. I just scroll down here a little bit in my Google Doc. All right, so players I have confirmed for doing interviews. Brooke Lilly from Gilderland, the Wolf Sisters from Greenwich, Both Boston Spa athletes, Jessica Bowens and Kaylee Richards. Me and Natal, friend of the show, will be there and in living color. We'll get her to jump on board as well. Also, after the event, definitely have Sydney Pleat locked in. And then I have also confirmed that Summer Perry from Broadalbin and Perth and Gianna Winter from Shenandoah will also swing by the table, say hi, you know, shake hands, kiss babies, that whole thing. So,
yep,
that's the way things are looking. Yeah, we're rocking and rolling. We're getting out there. We're getting out in the community. Let's go.
It'd be fun. And hopefully it's not 89 degrees out like it's been the last 5 days, next in a couple of weeks. But I mean, it's perfect. 77 is perfect. We just had this is fall summer currently right now. If you look at the chart, there's a whole chart of what time of New York it is. It's currently fall summer, and then it'll be real fall in about a couple of weeks.
That sounds about right. And then that'll go through basically to right around Christmas time, essentially. Yep. Yeah, the real fall is really October 1st through Thanksgiving, maybe even a week or two after.
You know, fall is called autumn, by the way, too. I asked Alexa, and she'll turn on real quick, but I asked her when was fall start, and she said autumn starts on, who knew?
You know, why do we need to have two words for the same season?
I don't know. Like, who knew fall was autumn? There's kids with names both. Like, there's girls and boys, whoever, they have their name is fall and autumn. So, like, technically, like, what season are you?
What came first?
Right, fall or autumn. I don't know.
We'll have to look into that.
I say the chicken, if nothing else.
We'll have to look into that. Trying to think if there's anything else. Not the plug. I'm not sure. Let's see here. There's a couple of newsworthy notes, but I think the guest for our next episode might be interested in talking about those topics as well. So we'll save those for another time. Real quick though, because you know, not to be a Debbie Downer to end the show, but we did mention the Bethlehem situation in the introduction of the show. But I also want to send out our thoughts to the Boston Spa community, because we haven't been able to really talk about it at all or make reference to it. But the athletic director, David Slunkies Jr., he unfortunately passed away suddenly back on Saturday, September 7th. I think he was in his like mid to late 50s.
40s. Too. 40s.
Oh, 40s. Oh, sorry. Yeah. Very sudden. Definitely a hit to the community as somebody who knows a few families from Boston Spa. I know that the community was pretty rocked by it. I know the football team for the Scotties, they just paid tribute to him at their first home football game since his passing this past weekend. So definitely a loss for the community, and our thoughts and prayers obviously go out to the family and everyone at the Boston Spa school district for going through a hard time. I know can't be easy to lose somebody, especially right as the school year starts. Definitely leaves a big hole to be filled, regardless of the fact. So,
And reading all the stuff I may have exchanged emails at some point back and forth just for games and stuff, but just reading some of the comments and stuff like that from some of the kids, because he was a gym teacher, he was a PE, gym's a class, not a place, PE teacher. Like everybody, like saying how great he was coaching the boys and the men, whether it be like the girls loving him being a coach. So it's definitely hard for a community like that, especially Boston Spa is a super close knit community. I feel like it's a big community, but in a small space, if that makes sense. So, but we definitely, I'm glad that you mentioned something like that, because we definitely pass on our deep sympathy to that whole community and his family. And you find out who they really are usually afterwards. And it's been nothing but great things to hear about him. So it's been great.
Absolutely. Completely agree with you on that one. That being said, that wraps up episode 25 of 84 Feel with Cady and Cap. Don't forget, give us a follow on Twitter @84FeelPodcast. If you listen to us on Spotify, we thank you. Follow the channel, you know, ring the bell so that and that works on YouTube too for notifications on when new episodes drop. I know I get notifications when my favorite podcast on Spotify drop. It comes a little nice little push notification right there at the top of the screen. Just saying, you know, whatever. YouTube, same thing. Give us a like, subscribe, ring that notification bell, and, you know, drop a few comments on the videos you like. I know the YouTube videos have been popping the last few weeks between your girls, Alex and Maggie, dropping on the show, you know, dropping the word poop for the first time on this show.
Yeah, the comic. That was a comic special.
That was...
How many punches in the face? I'm going to punch this person in the face, and I'm going to do this. Like, you just see what I'm dealing with. It's just, there's and you heard Alex talk about Alex and Maddie, like, they love each other, but they're learning to love each other. It's slowly happening.
The funny thing is, I knew Alex had that personality. I honestly didn't know a whole lot about Maggie. I just saw her personality the weekend I announced back in April at your AAU event.
Yep.
I got to see her personality a little bit when she was, with her AAU teammates a little bit. So I was like, all right, she's got personality. Yeah. But she was a whole nother level last week. So that was pretty cool. That's good to see.
That was good. Yeah, the one thing you have to do for me, obviously Bobby's thing's coming up, but you have to make sure you ask Gianna Winter who her favorite texter is and see what her answer is. That's kind
favorite
of
favorite texter.
A favorite texter. Who's the person she likes the most? Like, if she had to have one text for the day, who would she want it to come from? You ask her that.
I'm assuming it's somebody from her team on Elevate is what you're going
to answer. It'll be a perfect question, and she'll be like, oh, my God, who told you to ask this?
Okay, favorite texter. I'm going to make a note of this right now on my Google Doc for the...
she had to get one text a day. Who would she want the text to come from?
Who would she want one text a day from? Okay. That'll be my way of remembering. Okay. All right. Cool. I'm just going to hope that G doesn't see this before
She's too busy. She's in... Who knows? She's got... What season is it?
She plays five sports, has nine clubs. Something.
She's got either giving blood, she's helping old ladies cross the street.
She's working on being an Eagle Scout. I don't know. She's
tying knots, be places. Who knows?
That's beyond me. Beyond me. I was actually shocked because I was in Clifton Park to get bagels of all things. West End Bagels, I think, is the name of the place. Yep. And I happened to be on my way there, and I dropped her a text asking for her opinion on the place. I was stunned. She texted me so quick. I'm like, wow, the mayor was able to get back to me quick. That's nice. That's cool.
Yeah.
I was like, all right, okay. Somebody's got the phone on the hip. All right.
No, she usually takes a little while, so she's learning.
Well, that all being said, all right. That's it. We're done. Yeah. Enjoy your weekend. Enjoy this beautiful weather because, like you said, it's been stunning. And it doesn't look like it's stopping anytime soon, you know, knock on wood. So we're good. It's all good. Cap, enjoy your mood lighting, and I'll see you next show, all right?
All right, sounds good.
Later.
See ya.